two points of significant extension. In the first one, we're going to show you why culture undermines responsibility. In the second one, we're going to talk to you about the impact this is going to have on those communities. Notice two things that are important. Number one, since the legal system is not a utilitarian system, since it works mostly on deserved-based consideration, since we do not send one innocent man to jail and prefer 100 guilty men to go free, we think that the practical case of the opening opposition is not relevant if we win the principal case. Despite that, we're still going to be there. Notice point two. The whole of the case of that Ethan just brought up relied on the idea that we are imposing the minority culture on the victim. If we can show you the coercive nature of culture also on the person performing the crime, we win this debate by OO's own metric, because we show you that that person is just as much a victim of that culture as his own victim, and therefore we should not punish them. So let's start with this. Oh, just one last thing, sorry, about Aitken's wonderful point about the state's obligation to prioritize state culture, blah, 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 blah. We think there are so many other better mechanisms to do this than specifically through the courts and specifically through punishing innocent people. For example, the education system, the public media, the general culture in the state. We don't think we should do it through the courts. We definitely don't think we should do it through punishing people who are not to blame. So let's start with talking about why these people are not to blame. We think our opening has done a wonderful job of telling us that you were raised that way. We think they haven't elaborated enough on how exactly that impacts you. We think that OO attacked us by saying, well, you have many influences. So let's talk exactly about how culture influences you. Five reasons for that. I love doing the helping thing. So first of all, we tell you that you are exposed to it from a very young age. What this means is that the prism through which you see the world is shaped by that culture. All of your engagement with the world is shaped by that culture. What this means, it means first of all that your definition of good and bad changes, right? Oftentimes we say not knowing the law is not an issue because we think you have those basic instincts of good and bad. But if you were shaped in a certain way, so as for example say to value your honor more than your life, I don't know, maybe wrong fine, then that means you value good and bad in a different way. We think that changes tremendously the way you engage with the state, the way you engage with laws. But moreover, we tell you this constitutive moral act, the fact that you are wholly dependent upon what you were raised, means that you are eliminated your responsibility because it is an arbitrary decision to which you are not yourself accountable. It is about the way you were raised and the values that were introduced to you within your education. Moreover, we tell you, notice this is, of course, is very unlike poverty, which doesn't change your system of good and bad. But notice, moreover, that we tell you, no, that your approach to the law is shaped through this mechanism. First of all, because you interact with your culture much sooner than you interact with the law. This means that both the importance of the law, how important it is to respect the law, but also the key contents of the law are parasitical on the way you perceive them through this prism of culture. And this means that all of your interpretations of the law and all of the way you understand the law is shaped through this prism of your culture. We think this is very important because this means that you cannot actually be accountable for the way you act in accordance with the law based on these two things. But notice also that you are incredibly dependent upon your community. It shapes your framework, it shapes your day-to-day life, it shapes all of your interactions. This means our opening has already said that, granted, that it is more influential than the state. But this means two additional, more important things. First of all, it means that it is much harder to resist because it is constant, this is all encompassing, this keeps on surrounding you, and this keeps on being reinforced through your interactions with the world, meaning that it is much harder for you to actually resist this in a way that is coercive. We also tell you that this defines what is reasonable to you. Now notice that in courts we often judge based on what a reasonable person would do. But all of your definitions of reasonableness are based on your interactions with society, which are shaped by your culture. Closing.
And that is a wonderful thing, a case. It may be to ban certain cultures, not to give them a carte blanche on committing crimes in the name of the culture.
Okay, number one, I don't think we're giving them a carte blanche based on the mechanism from OG. Number two, we already know that banning religions isn't effective, but I'm going to deal with that in the practical case and show you why banning is actually worse and also this law, the status quo is worse. I just want to finish off with this idea of the reasonable person and tell you, at the end of the day, much like Sellers POI, in the same way that we don't punish children because we think they can't distinguish right from wrong, in the same way we don't punish mentally ill people because we think they don't have the understanding and because they view the world through a significantly different prism than sane people, is precisely why all the reasons I just detailed indicate that we shouldn't punish these people as well. But let's talk about the impact. Because opening up talked about how they strengthen the narrative, the radical narratives. Notice these are isolated minority communities. Their leaders gain political power through portraying themselves as opposing the state. This is, first of all, why deterrence doesn't work, right? Because we're not deterring the right people, the people who broke the crime. We are not, we are deterring the ones theoretically who are reporting the crime. We're not deterring the leaders who are the ones who actually have the coercive power. Notice, for example, the Bukini scandal in France. It only increased radicalism within Islamic circles. It also made moderate Muslim women wear the Bukini. We tell you that when we punish the individuals, we allow them to become martyrs, we allow them to become the victims, as I pointed out, and thus allow those political leaders to capitalize significantly on this, therefore strengthening the extremist narrative. Now they can portray themselves as the victim, now they can also portray these actions as rebellion against the state. And since these are isolationist minority communities, they gain power through that. What is the right way to engage with those communities? Through education, through engagement, through moderation. This is more likely to succeed because this empowers moderate leaders at the expense of these radicals, which you are now strengthening. We have seen this work in Israel in the case of arranged marriages in the Yemenite community, who used to marry girls at a very young age. The state decided that they don't want to fight through criminalizing it, precisely because this is likely to only radicalize them, and decided to gain a moderate approach. Now the average age of marriage amongst the Yemenite communities in Israel is 17, as opposed to 12, which it was before. We think that at the end of the day, engagement is a better process. We think that these people are victims just as much, and based on all those metrics, we are very proud to propose.